FB First Family Ministry Podcast. We have an awesome episode today. Our mission here is equipping families to navigate life with God's truth. We have Dr. Jonathan Williams in the house with us today. We are so excited to have him on the podcast talking about gospel family. What does that look like? How do we make a mission statement, a value statement? What is the process on that? We're going to go through that today. So without further ado, man, and we got Josh on the podcast, Pastor Josh as well.
Yeah,
I mean, it's second time ever on the podcast. We decided to invite him back. You know, we guess it would be best to...
I'm glad I didn't do anything the last time to, like, you know, diminish my opportunity to be back.
Yeah, absolutely. No, you did a good job. You were on your best behavior.
Thank you. Well, we are excited to have Dr. Williams with us today. Just real quick for our listening audience, I just want to introduce him real quick so that you guys know who he is and also where you can find him and follow him and find some more of his resources. So Dr. Williams is the founder of Gospel Family Ministries, which is a ministry devoted to encouraging families to bring the gospel into their homes. He's a published author with books titled Gospel Family and a new one he just had published, A Practical Theology of Family Worship. These books are targeted towards families who long to see their families walking with Christ. Jonathan's married to his wife, Jessica, and they have three awesome kids, Gracie, Silas, and Elijah. With a heart for families and the church, Jonathan previously served for 10 years as the senior pastor at Wilcrest Baptist Church, which is a multi-ethnic church in the Houston area with families from 50 different nations. Jonathan received his PhD in family ministry and biblical counseling through the School of Education at Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary, where he now teaches as an adjunct professor, and Jonathan is also the managing editor of the Southwestern D6 Family Ministry Journal, which is one of the leading resources for how families can return to a biblical model of discipling their children. Dr. Williams, welcome to the podcast.
Hey, thanks so much. Good to be here. Appreciate it.
Man, I'm so excited to talk about family vision and values. This is a concept that somebody introduced to me through college and then again at a conference. And my wife and I recently walked through this process of creating a vision and values and mission statement. And I'm so excited for you to share this with our families today. So, I mean, let's get into it, bro.
All right. No, thank you. It's good to be here. Good to talk about it.
Oh, yeah. Awesome. Awesome. Just go ahead and jump in, man. What you got?
Yeah, so we talk a lot about how to bring God's word into the home. And I think part of that, part of catching a vision of God's heart for your home is maybe developing this family mission statement. I think a lot of times we get busy with life. We just kind of go day to day, week to week without a lot of intentionality. We just want to make it through our busy schedules. And this is a call to take a step back, push pause on all the busyness, and really to seek God's heart for our home. And to even to that end, develop some sort of mission statement, some sort of goal, a prayer that we can be praying. It's not saying this is where we are, we've arrived, but it is saying this is a prayer we have for our family. This is the kind of family we believe God has called us to be, and we're going to write that down and pray over it and talk about it throughout the days. And so one of our examples, of course, of doing that is Joshua, the famous verse from Joshua 24:15, where he says, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
That's good.
So just, are we able to say, as for me and my house, we will, you know, me and my family, we will be this kind of family. We will do these kinds of things. And this is something that someone put on our heart years ago when my wife and I were early in our marriage. And so as the kids got older, we got a chance to sit down with them and to talk about that, to ask the questions, well, what has God called us to be as a family? What has God called us to do as a family? And to actually kind of write something down. I don't know if that's similar to what y'all did when y'all went through it this summer.
Yeah, no. So for us, man, it was something very much like that. You know, somebody said, look up a list of, you know, like a bunch of words, like descriptive words of family, some like virtues of family words. So we looked it up, massive list, like 130 words, right? So we went through that and we kind of like narrowed down like a little bit, like, okay, what are the words that are specific to our family? You know, what are the things that, it's going to be different for every family. Every family has different struggles. Every family has different contexts. Every family has different things they're up against, you know? So we looked through those and we narrowed it down to about 10, 15 words each. And then we came together And we prayed together and prayed over those words and said, you know, what ones can we kind of combine together, you know, that are very similar? And then what of those words, you know, are unique in their meaning? And what's kind of the thought process behind each one of those things for us? And as we prayed through that, man, like the Lord really showed us and helped us to narrow it down to about, you know, six of them that we were able to identify, like, man, these ones right here, these ones really are what we want our family to embody, you know, and we don't have any kids right now. And so, of course, you know, Josh tells me these things change over time, you know, and I believe him mostly, you know, no, but these things change. And so, but for right now, those are kind of, you know, what we said, that's kind of our process, but I know everybody does it a little differently. So.
No, I love that. I do agree. I think it kind of grows with the family.
Yeah.
You know, different seasons call for different focuses. I think as you add kids or the kids getting different ages, we see that even in our home as the kids have gotten older, there's different things we focus on. But some of those big term words and pictures that you have in your statement, they can mean so much. So if you write down that we want to be a gospel family, you know, that impacts you at every stage of life. Now, what you talk about and what it means to be a gospel family might look different as the kids get older, that kind of thing. But exactly what you're talking about is what we encourage families to do, to think about what does God's word say about the kind of family we're supposed to be? Are we supposed to be a great commandment family that loves God and loves our neighbor? Yeah. Are we supposed to be a great commission family that's making disciples? Are we supposed to be hospitable, gracious, loving? What kind of things are we supposed to do? Are we supposed to do the one another's, love one another, pray with one another, praise the Lord with one another, teach the word of God to one another? So you think through, I think, a lot of what the scriptures say. I think another, even looking at Joshua 24, another way to approach this is to ask the question, what's going to keep us from living this mission statement out? What's going to be the greatest obstacles? Because Joshua, right before he says, as for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord, he tells everybody listening to get rid of the idols in their lives. He says, there's going to be lesser loves. There's going to be idols. There's going to be other things, worldly things that capture your heart. And those are going to be the greatest challenge to be in the family that God's called you to be. And I wanted to share, there's a story in the Bible where a dad leads really well in getting rid of the idols. And it's a good example for us as we're thinking about what's going to get in the way of us being that kind of family. In Genesis 35, God calls Jacob to lead his family to Bethel to go dwell with God. And so he wants to lead his family to dwell with God. Hopefully that's a desire we have. We want to lead our families to dwell and delight in the presence of God. But before he can do that, he knows they have some idols in their home they got to get rid of. So he tells the whole family, he says, go through the house, room to room, gets all the idols, bring them to me. They put them in the bag. They go to the backyard. They dig a hole and they bury them. And only once they've gotten rid of those worldly things that could keep them from loving God, then he's ready to go lead his family to dwell with God. So I think part of that discovering our mission statement journey is saying, what's going to keep us from doing this? What do we have in our schedules? What do we have in our homes and our hearts and our lives that right now is taking a higher priority than it needs to have? And how can we lead our families to get rid of those things and actually go and bury them in the backyard? And now we can be that kind of family he wants us to be.
I love that. I love that. And I love what you said yesterday in a session. You said, you know, in all businesses that we go through or whatnot, you know, they all have mission statements. They all have value statements. They all have, this is what our purpose is. Because if not, any business owner knows that if you don't have a direct mission statement or values for what your company is, you're going to be all over the place. This guy's going to be pulling this direction. This guy's going to be pulling this direction. And then they're going to come together, get frustrated at each other. What are we even doing? And so I love how you compared it to that, because that's like the family. If the family is working together, man, and I know that's your heart, when the family's working together, pulling at the same way, the same time, the same strength, it's like those two ox that are pulling that plow at the same, you know, time and with the same yoke and being yoked together, just moving forward, they're able to get so much done, man, and able so much done for the kingdom. If you're focused on those things, even though some may be changing our mission, you know, that doesn't change as the family. So that guiding light, even though the situations in our life might change, we might move to a different area, get a different job, you know, our mission doesn't change. It's still the same. We're the same family. We're the Murdoch family. You know, you're the Wood family. You're the Tortora family. You know, you're the Williams family. And that's what God's created us to be. So.
Well, that's so good. And what I love about that passage about Jacob is we have a father here.
Yeah.
Leading the family.
Yeah.
And that is one thing that in America and even in the Christian church is missing so much. dads not taking the step and saying, hey, we're going to do this. I know it's going to be hard for everybody, but we're going to do this. We're committed to it. And you see the family following the father. And, you know, they went through the whole house. They went through every room, find the idols, go out, and they bury them so that they're not going to turn back. It's not like they put them in the cupboard. It's not like they, you know, went and took them out of sight. You know, you may have some things where, you know, in your house, it's like, oh, man, that family's coming over, or hide the deck of cards or something. You know, it wasn't like they just went and hit them. No, they got rid of them. Right. They buried them, and then they decided, we're going to move forward in this direction.
Like, no more idols. They're gone.
That's right. And they were unified, and so good. But it was the leadership of a husband following the leadership of the Lord that was able to lead the family, and they followed well. So
I love that. Well, and maybe, you know, speak a little bit, you know, we live in a broken world, you know, and we live in a world where, you know, sometimes God's ideal for things is not, you know, perpetuated in our lives, you know, in all of our lives in different ways and different circumstances. What would you guys kind of say? And Jonathan, maybe speak to this, you know, maybe a family, you know, that has a single dad or a single mom, or, you know, maybe there's a separation there, or, you know, maybe speak to, you know, the spouse is not a Christian, and, you know, those different dynamics that we experience in this world. How does one develop kind of that values, mission, and vision statement in that circumstance?
Yeah, absolutely. Because I think, like you said, that is a common dynamic. We don't always have a father in a home who is a Christian or who is leading. And I would just give us two quick examples from Scripture. One, we talked about with our church family here this weekend, but in Timothy, we don't know a lot about Timothy's dad, but we know he's Greek, and it looks like he didn't let Timothy get circumcised as a young age. And so that's why Timothy had to do that later on in age. But what we do know was in that home where the dad wasn't leading spiritually, Timothy had a mother and a grandmother, Lois and Eunice, who were discipling him, were pouring into him. And so that's what I would encourage. If there's a single mom out there, if there's a mom whose husband is not leading spiritually, pour into your kids. Do everything you can to pass your faith down to them, to take the lead in discipling them. And so Lois and Eunice, Timothy's mother and grandmother, they did. They taught him the word of God from childhood. And as an adult, he's now this young pastor who still has that foundation that they put in his life. Now, I would encourage single moms who are taking the lead in that, pouring into their kid, discipling the kid. If you have a husband in the home who's not leading, keep praying that God would raise him up as a spiritual leader. And when God does start to move in his life, then I would encourage you to let him then kind of take some of that lead. And I've talked to families where the husband wants to start leading, and the wife says, no, you've checked out for 5 years. I've kind of gotten used to doing it. I'm going to keep running the show here. Or the dad feels like he doesn't really have a way to step into that. So that's the other dynamic, is once God is moving in his heart and he wants to step in, he wants to take the lead, he wants to be a part of that, how do we make that transition? How do we welcome him into that role in a joyful way? The other passage I would just throw out there is in 1 Peter 3, where Peter talks to wives whose husbands are not obeying the word of God. So whether that's your husband's not a Christian, or your husband is a Christian, but he has little interest in church or faith or discipling the kids. And Peter's call to the wives in that passage is to just be a godly wife, to lead by example, to set such an example. No matter what your husband brings to the table, you're bringing a godly example. On his worst days, you're being loving and gracious and respectful. And he's saying, how in the world can you love me on a day like this? And he starts to see, oh, it must be the love of Christ. That thing you keep talking about must be real, because even on my worst days, you're showing grace and forgiveness and patience and love. And Peter says God could use that example of that godly wife to actually win the heart of her husband.
I think just to chime in there too, your children also can be instrumental in getting the husband involved, because it's their questioning and conviction and their desire to have their dad as part of this conversation and leading this conversation. Maybe it's just your child asking, Dad, will you pray at dinner? Or some other rhythm that you've put in place with the kids that the kid actually gets the dad involved.
Oh, absolutely. I've seen times where a child gives their life to the Lord and is talking about their kid's baptism. And even at the baptism, that all of a sudden you see the dad kind of engaging a little bit more, and the Lord does. He uses that to impact their heart and bring them to say, okay, I need to know what this is about. I want to pay more attention to this, and often to just give their lives to Christ.
That's such an amazing testimony. I love that. Well, man, I Is there any resources for the families? What resources would you give when it comes to this, you know, starting this process? My wife and I, we just kind of, I don't know if this is good, but we just Googled, you know, like list of virtues, you know, and you know, pretty good. We were able to discern some of them like, that's probably not good. But, you know, the rest of them pretty good. What resources would you say for families going into this?
Yeah, Chap Bettis has a book called The Disciple Making Parent, where he gets into some of these conversations. I leaned on a lot of books from the Puritans. Richard Baxter has a book called The Godly Home, where he talks a lot about the markers of a godly home. Our book, Gospel Family, is a book I wrote. We have a whole section there on family mission statement. Our website, gospelfamily.org, we have mission statement cards and other templates you can download. And I've had friends who, you know, they'll write down their mission statement on a piece of paper, put it on the refrigerator, or put it on the mirror in the bathroom in their house. I've had friends who's taken their mission statement and almost turned it into like art that they hang up in the house.
That's cool.
There's something about keeping it in front of you, somehow finding a way to keep that right in front of you. And again, it's not saying we've arrived or this is how we always are. We're going to have our days where we feel very far from that mission statement, but it's saying, after much prayer and looking at the word, this is the family God's called us to be. And this is our prayer. This is our mission. And we're on our way to be in that family. And some days are better than others.
Yeah, 100%, 100%. Miss Erin, we've had, thank you so much for talking about that and jumping into, you know, what is family, discipleship, and worship in the confines of mission, vision, and values. And I hope that's helpful for you guys and for those watching online. Just, you know, being intentional about getting in those resources and carving out that time to invest in that. I know for me, I listen to a lot of audiobooks, like 100%. Like most of the books that I consume are audiobooks, and I usually listen to them really fast. Just because, you know, did you know that scientific studies say that if you listen to like a book fast, you actually retain it better? Did you know?
No.
Yeah. I don't know. Some scientists.
Is that soul
somewhere,
people? I don't know.
So maybe not. I know for me. I know for me it is, but.
I thought it just like helped me get through the book faster.
No, Josh. Science, no, that's not.
Yeah,
it does.
So do you put it like on high speed mode?
Like 1.5.
Like it sounds like the chipmunks?
Yeah. Well, typically. Well, with Albert Moeller, I'll put it on 2 sometimes.
We got to speed this up.
We do. No offense, Albert Moeller. I love listening to your briefing.
Do you think that's what people are doing on your podcast right now? They're
right now, yeah.
Do you think Albert Moeller is listening?
That would be awesome if he is. Shout out.
Great. He is. He sped it up, right?
Right. Man, well, our families have proposed some great questions over the course of this week, and you guys can still put in questions. We're seeing a live feed right now of the questions coming in. So if you guys think of, you know, a follow-up question or something, we've got a good amount of time to jump into those. Miss Erin's going to lead us through those questions. And we're just, I mean, Dr. Williams, feel free to, you know, jump in and answer. We'd love for you to answer. Josh, too, jump in, with your wisdom, and we'll just go from there.
You can jump in too.
Okay.
So the first one is low-hanging fruit. So does it count for family worship time if I watch episodes of The Chosen with my 12-year-old son?
Yeah, I think anything we can do to open up conversations, talk about the Lord, you know, there can be benefits to that. And so I think there are a lot of technology, a lot of videos, a lot of apps out there that allow us to start talking about the Lord, introduce Jesus to our kids. So I think it's encouraging to hear families saying, okay, all the technology, all the shows, all the apps, all the movies, can we find some that can get this conversation going in the house? Absolutely. That's one thing we do with family worship and music. I don't play any instruments, so we'll use YouTube videos and find a worship song that has the words on it. We'll play it on the TV, or we'll use some kind of app that is Spotify or something playing some Christian worship songs. And so I think there's a lot of ways we can use technology. I would encourage families to still find those opportunities to actually open up scripture. And so I think the tech gives us some entry points, and then we can kind of build off of that and do some other things as well.
Yeah, I think the technology side of it is definitely a way to engage our children and our teens or preteens in a way that they're not going to necessarily like shut you down right at the beginning. You know, you get them interested. Hey, we're going to watch an episode, or we're going to watch part of an episode, and then we're going to talk about it a little bit, you know. So it can get that conversation started. I would encourage the person asking the question, though, not to lean on the technology to be their devotion, because the most important influence in that 12-year-old's life is their parents. And so while The Chosen is a great resource, we don't want to allow The Chosen to be the only influence in that child's life.
Absolutely. And I think that's a good segue to realizing there are discipleship opportunities all day, any conversation with your child. I know for my husband and I, we've let our kids watch movies that that were, you know, sentimental from when we were younger that weren't necessarily Christian movies, but we watched them and then during the movie, we'll kind of look at each other like, ooh, that might not have been so wholesome, which
was opens, that there before?
But is that always there? But it opens for a great discussion afterward and then diving in kind of to unintentional discipleship or unintentional worship where you can really dive into what does the word say about this, that something we never gave a second thought for, you know, something we saw back when we were younger. So great question. Thank you so much for submitting. The next question, I am against my 13-year-old having a phone due to the obvious risks to protect her. I want us all to have the other benefits too. So this parent is concerned with providing this technology. I have an answer for this, but I'd love to hear yours first.
I would just say we went through this. I'd always told my kids, they're like, when do we get a smartphone? And I was like, maybe when you're 16, you know, if you're driving, I want you to have maps. I want you to be able to call me. And so that was kind of our thought. But my daughter's 13 now. When she was 11, we went to the hospital, was in ICU for a whole week, and it was a real scary time. And she ended up being diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. So now we're in this new rhythm of, you know, 5 shots a day and taking her blood and monitor her blood and all that. And so after months of doing that, we start getting her on these different devices that she wears all the time, every day, all day. And so one of them's giving her insulin and the other one's monitoring her blood sugar. But all of this works with an iPhone. And so we started trying just to use my phone or my wife's phone. But then if I left for work, then we couldn't monitor things because it has to be 10 feet close to her. Or if my wife went to the store, we couldn't monitor. So when my daughter was 11, in the middle of going through all this stuff and trying to learn this medical rhythm, we ended up buying her an iPhone. And so it's kind of, for her, like a little silver lining with everything she was going through. She's like, well, at least I got a phone. But what we needed the benefits of having that technology. We needed that phone to monitor her medical situations, her health, her blood sugar. But we told her when we gave it to her, just because you have a phone doesn't mean you're allowed to have any app you want or do anything the phone is able to do. And so we still have a lot of boundaries, a lot of restrictions. She's not allowed to get any app that we don't first approve. She's not allowed social media whatsoever. And so, and we tell her we own the phone, we pay for the phone, it's our phone, you get to use it. So we check it all the time. We check her text messages. We check anything she's doing on the phone. She gets that. And so I think if there's a time where we need those benefits for whatever reason, you know, one, they have the dumb phones out there that all they do is make phone calls for kids. But even if you have to have a smartphone for whatever reason, like we did, I think there's still some discipleship, some boundaries, some restrictions we can place to not just say carte blanche, anything out there you can have.
Yeah, that's great. And the dumb phone is, so you called it, that's a suggestion that I have. A friend asked us recently about that. And having not been through that yet with our children, I let them be the guinea pig. I said, I've heard of this thing called, it's Gab phone is one, but I'm sure there are other resources out there. And so they've had it for a few months for their 11-year-old.
We are not sponsored by Gab.
We are not sponsored. That's one example of a few different options out there, but kind of gave that to them to test it out and let us know. And the report has been positive where the child, when they're dropped off at practices or whatever, they can still call and text the parents but have no access to anything else. So that's certainly one way. And then when you were talking about the iPhone specifically, or even just any phone with apps, you can set it where you can actually have to receive approvals. And there's a whole checklist you had mentioned earlier. Resource for how to go through those notifications in those phone settings. And I think that's something we'll link to in the show where we can have walk step by step through that process.
Yeah, Andy Crouch has a book called The Tech Wise Family, and that even includes kind of a iPhone or cell phone contract between the parent and the kid. And so the day you hand them the phone, before they even turn it on, you've already walked through. Because when a kid gets their first phone, they're pretty accepting of any rule. You know, they'll say yes to just about anything to get that phone. And that's the time to have that kind of ground rules right away and say, all right, here's how we're going to approach this. Here's how we're going to handle some things. And so the TechWise family gives us some of those guidelines, but also even has a contract that parents and kids could enter into and say, this is our agreement. This is our understanding. Now we all know what to expect.
Yeah, I'll jump in there too real quick, just about technology and cell phones. If your family decides we're not going to have cell phones with our teenagers or with our children, by the way, not a bad choice, great decision. But if you make that decision, don't think that that excuses you from having conversations about technology. Just because they don't have their own device doesn't mean that they won't ever have access to a device. In my years as youth pastor, I can't tell you how many parents I've talked to that said, you know, hey, my child doesn't have a device, but I just found out they have a TikTok account or they have a Snapchat account because they take their friends' devices and they create their own accounts. And so sometimes as parents, we think by just withholding the technology, it shields them from all the dangers of technology. And that's not true. So continue to have those conversations of responsible tech use. Also, if you're setting boundaries and saying, hey, you have a smartphone, but you're not allowed to have these social medias, make that clear to them that that includes other people's devices, your tablet, all that as well.
Yeah, that's good. That's really good. I know. Well, in like, even when I was 11 years old, you know, I was attending, I really loved, you know, theater, drama, stuff like that, you know, growing up as a homeschool student, shout out. But basically we literally would go there for practice and get ready for the play or whatnot. And, you know, there were some boys there that they had their own iPods, iPod Touch, you know, when that first came out. And they were just looking at inappropriate stuff, you know, on it. And they showed me that inappropriate stuff. And, you know, that wasn't good. And so, like, even though I didn't get my first phone, which was a shared phone, until I was like 16, I still was influenced by social media, phones, things like that. So, Josh, I definitely echo what you said there. About making sure to have those conversations, you know, even if, you know, technology is something that your family's decided not to do.
That's so great. Our next question comes in, how do you create rhythms for your family without it becoming legalistic? That's a great question.
I love the question because that is a prayer that we have, right? We're not just after behavior modification. We're not after just some legalistic checklist. I think it'd be very easy to raise good, nice, polite kids that do what they're told and then still be lost, far from the Lord. You know, we see it as Jesus was engaging the Pharisees, and these guys knew the law, and yet their heart was far from them. They looked good on the outside. Jesus called them whitewashed tombs. Like, they look good on the outside. We cleaned the tomb, but inside was just dead bones. And so we can raise well-behaved, polite kids with good manners that do what they're told, and their heart can still be far from the Lord. So I love the question that, you know, it's all about the heart. It's not just about their behavior. We want to really get to the heart. So I think one of that is just to kind of gauge and check in as you're bringing rhythm to the home. You're having some family prayer. You're opening up the Word of God together. You're sharing testimonies together. You're finding the ways to do this. You know, you kind of just gauge, you know, how are our kids responding? Do we see the Lord moving? And do we need to change something? Maybe, you know what, when we shared prayer requests, I feel like they open up a little bit more. So let's lean into that. There is the ongoing prayer, too. What I would say, though, is even if we're bringing rhythms in and we feel like it's not impacting the kids, we don't stop. We don't say, well, we tried it and we gave up. You know, it's kind of like sharing the gospel. If you go share the gospel with someone who doesn't know Jesus and they don't give their life to the Lord, they slam the door in your face, you don't say, well, I tried it. I'm not sharing the gospel anymore. You know, because the Great Commission is still there. We're still commanded to go make disciples. And so if we try to bring these rhythms in and our kids don't seem to be responding well, Deuteronomy 6 and Deuteronomy 32 and Ephesians 6 are still there. We're still commanded to teach them the Word of God. We're commanded to disciple them. So we have to keep trying. We have to keep finding those ways. What is going to get through to their heart? Again, I told a story this weekend about a man who tried this with his kids, who turned off the radio while they were driving, encouraged them, prayed over them, and there was zero response. And for 3 weeks, he thought he didn't get through to them. He didn't get to their heart whatsoever because no one said anything. And 3 weeks later, that same son, eighth grade boy, asked his dad, hey, would you do that again? Would you share some blessings over me? Would you encourage me? Would you pray over me? So even though he thought he wasn't getting through to him, he actually had penetrated their heart. And for 3 weeks, the kid was wondering, when are you going to do that again? And what I've seen is a lot of times, even when the kids seem disinterested, if they get used to that rhythm, if you stay consistent, I think by the power of the Holy Spirit in time, the Lord will penetrate their heart. And that's what we're depending on, right? We can do all the right things, But it's not our job to change their heart. It's not our job to save them. We can't do those things. We're just going to be faithful. We're going to be consistent. We're going to be prayerful, and then pray that in time, the Lord will get the heart.
Yeah, that's so good. And talking about just rhythms and being consistent about things, your kids pick up on that. Your kids pick up on that. They depend on it, actually. If you are consistent enough, they will start to think about their day through the spiritual touches that you're able to give them. Just real quick example, I've got a 11-year-old son who most people look at him and think, oh, well, he's a tough kid. He's a tough kid. He's a strong kid. I mean, he is. He's a big boy. He plays baseball. And so a lot of people will look at him as a tough kid and they'll think, oh, well, you know, he doesn't need to be cherished or loved or valued as much because he's confident and tough and all that. When I go and tuck my children in at night at bedtime, you know, I'll sit down on their bed. I'll talk to them. I'll ask them how their day went. I'll pray over them. You know, I touch them physically. I will touch them. I will hug them. I'll kiss them. And that's so important for kids to have. Well, sometimes you send the kid up to bed and it's like, oh, well, I'm doing this or I'm finishing an email or I'm doing the dishes or whatever. By the time I get up to the bedroom to tuck them in, they're asleep. And so one night this was the case. And so I went up there to tuck them in and my son had already fallen asleep. And so I just went in and just kind of like touched him on the head and said a quick prayer and went on my way. And he said, and then as I'm walking out of the room, he rolls over. He goes, but Dad, didn't you want to know about my day? You know? And he said, Dad, you didn't hug me. You just put your hand on my head. Even those things, like you don't think it matters. You don't realize the impact it's having. So I would be less concerned about the legalistic side of it and be more concerned about, hey, this is my heart. Yeah. This is my heart for my child. And so if my child wants to judge this and through some type of lens, or if I have to check my own heart to make sure I'm not being legalistic about it, those are all things to consider. But not doing it is not something to consider.
Yeah, 100%, 100%. The discipline is still the discipline, you know? Yeah, I love that.
That's so good. And thank you so much for that. We've had some of our other questions answered in what we're doing. So we have time for one more. This last question is by contrast to what you had just said. So how do you have family worship with kids who are at college who have now decided that they don't believe in God? The school is teaching them that God does not exist. The parent wants to know, should they push forward with God? Do they just pray for them? How do they handle this?
I love it. I'll share a quick biblical example and a personal testimony from a buddy of mine. But one, I would say, yes, you do keep praying for them. You keep finding opportunities to show them the love of Christ, to share. I don't think we need to necessarily nag them or be pushy on it, right? And yet you keep that conversation going. You very wisely and prayerfully look for chances to share truth with them. I want it every time I call them saying, I really think you should find a church. Are you going to church? Did you go to church last night? You know, but you do show them the love of Christ. You keep that conversation going. You find ways to point them to the Lord. But the biblical example I would give has to do with probably with prayer. And I look at Job, and I'll be talking about that tomorrow and later this week. But when we meet Job in Job chapter 1, the Old Testament, he's an empty nester. His kids are grown, and they're out having parties, getting together at each other's house for feasts. And what we find Job doing is interceding for them. He's offering sacrifices for them in case they've sinned. And I think the New Testament application for us today would be interceding for them in prayer. And so when your kids are grown and they're out there and they're in the world, they're living their life, you know, we need to recommit to be that prayer warrior fighting for them in prayer to say, my kids are grown. I don't even know what they're doing right now, but I'm going to be praying for their heart. And I honestly, I've seen that. And that's a personal example I'd give is there's a friend of mine, a lady in Texas who had four boys. And when the oldest went to college, he just drifted from the faith, punted the whole thing, didn't want anything to do with God or church. He was all in on party life. And meanwhile, she's a stayed away. And so she just prayed. And she prayed and prayed. Every time he came home, she loved on him. She didn't nag on him. She loved on him. She looked for those little opportunities to kind of encourage him in the faith, to let him know, hey, I've been praying for you. He knew she was praying for him. And she did that for 5 years consistently, fighting in prayer for him. By the time I met this guy, he was a vibrant Christian in love with Christ. And to this day, his testimony will be, it's because my mom's prayers for me. While I was in college, she was praying. Every time I came home, she let me know she was praying. When she wrote me a note, she might include a little prayer in there. And he'll, to this day, he's a deacon in the church now, godly man leading his kids, praying for his kids now.
Yeah.
But he will attribute so much of his testimony to just the power of his mom's prayers as an empty nester.
That's amazing.
That's awesome. That's so good, Dr. Williams. And, you know, I'll just follow that up to this parent of, you know, just because your children don't seem to be interested in God does not mean your children are not interested in you. They love you. They care for you. And so the things that you love and the things that you care for, they will watch that. And so possibly one of the best things that you can do for your children, your adult children who aren't walking with the Lord, is for you to continue to stay faithful to the Lord. Because inevitably in this world, there will be issues. They will have troubles. This road they're walking down is a broken road. It's headed for heartache. It's headed for destruction. And so the Lord in his loving way will use that broken road to cause them to question the things that they're doing. And when they have those times of questions, you want to make sure that you are in a prime location. So you're staying close to the Lord, but you're also staying close to your children, and you're in a prime location to be the person that God uses. He might choose to use someone else. That's perfectly fine. But you want to make sure that you are staying in step with the Lord yourself so that when that time comes, you're prepared.
Yeah, thank you so much, guys. Thank you, Pastor Josh. Thank you, Dr. Jonathan Williams. Appreciate you. Let's give it up, studio audience, for these awesome guests here, right here. Thank you guys so much. You guys have been awesome. Hey, love y'all. See you later. Share this podcast if you found it helpful, and we'll see you next week on the FB First Family Ministry Podcast.